Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Chief Technology Officer, Amazon.com, Dr. Werner Borgholz.
Oh, I forgot something. I'll be back. Clicker. It's not their fault, yeah? That's my fault, yeah? I'm the one that's from a different time zone, let's put it like that. Welcome, Tokyo. Thank you all for coming out here today. It's impressive to see how much the AWS business has grown here in Japan. Many of you here were some of our earliest customers. Now, 10, 11 years ago, in 2006, when we launched our first services, quite a few of the younger Japanese businesses immediately knew that this was way too good a deal for them as well and joined us there. And so I want to stress that these days, this is an opportunity for learning. This is not a sales event. This is purely focused on education. And not only education from us talking to you, but I really urge you to look at the people around you, other people who may have been using AWS maybe already for 10 years. And there's so much that you can learn from each other. We have many different sessions for you today. Not only this keynote, and I'm very fortunate actually that in the keynote, I'll be joined by a number of our customers who will be telling you about how they're using AWS. Again, in many of the breakout sessions as well, we'll have many customers that will talk to you about how they're using AWS. So please learn from each other as well. Quite a few of you here, well over 20,000 developers, business people, business leaders are joining you here today at the AWS Summit. We have well over 150 different breakout sessions. Very fortunate to have well over 100 guest speakers, people that have been using AWS for a long time already, and will be able to tell you really how to use AWS in a daily business. And not just from our perspective, but really from a customer's perspective. And there's so much to learn from that. And of course, also go visit the different sponsor booths, but also there's a whole area of with young businesses that have built their business on AWS that I urge you to go check out, especially in the space of VR and AR and robotics and IoT. There's many exciting companies out there. So I want to start off with sort of giving you a quick update on the AWS business, and then we'll dive into sort of the different areas of AWS where we recently made quite a few updates, hoping that you can get a bit of a sense where AWS is going. Based on our financial results of the last quarter, AWS now is a $14 billion run rate company. That is quite spectacular. Still growing 43%. Year over year, and that is even while we are doing price reductions. So that's a pretty amazing growth. And we haven't stopped yet. Most importantly, I think if you compare this to quite a few of the other technology companies out there, if you see the amount of growth that is still happening, if you compare that to the newer companies, the new cloud-based companies like AWS, like ServiceNow, Workday, Salesforce, they are all growing still at a rapid rate, meaning that they really are serving their customers well. The old guard, they're all retracting. If you look at their financial numbers, it's clear that customers are understanding that the future is in the cloud and no longer on-premise with installed software. We have millions of customers that are active on our platform each month. Here in Japan, well over 100,000 active customers each month. That's a substantial number of businesses here that have made the decision to either migrate to the cloud or to build new products on the cloud. And we have customers out of every possible area, every type of business, small businesses like startups, small and medium businesses that are making use of often of software as a service, or large enterprises that are migrating from their data centers onto AWS. Clearly, we're the place where startups become successful. Almost from day one, we have built AWS to be able to support companies that want to reach internet scale. And here in Japan, for example, companies like Sansan, the business card application, or Merukari, the market app, or Wantedly, the business SNS app, all of those are growing up on AWS, helping them become successful, not only in Japan, but often worldwide. And the success of startups is really close, near to our heart. And that's why we have a specific program in place for startups. It's called Activate. And AWS Activate now gives startups up to $100,000 in credits for the first year to get started onto the platform. We also give you technical support for giving you solution architects that will work with you as a startup to make sure that you architect it in the right way so that you have full control over cost while still also being reliable, secure, scalable, all the other attributes that you want to have as a company. We really want to make sure that you architect it and build in such a way that you can be really successful on this platform. And with that, you also get business support and as well support from quite a few of our partners. So check out aws.amazon.com/activate if you're a young business, and check out the kind of offers that we have there available for you, and if you want to apply to the program. In terms of enterprises, there isn't a particular vertical that is not making use of AWS today. And here in Japan, companies like Entity Docomo or Epson or Fast Retailing, again, every possible vertical is represented on AWS. Many of these companies have a cloud-first strategy in place, meaning that every new application, every new product that is being built is now built on AWS, while they are also undergoing significant transformations and migrations of taking their on-premise systems of records and bringing them onto AWS as well. But not only business, also public sector makes use of AWS. For many of them, it is really important to be able to save as much cost as possible while reaching as many of their customers or citizens or whatever you want to call their customers as much as possible. And so whether that is government agencies or whether that is new educational systems such as Coursera and Blackboard, or whether it's universities. For example, Tokyo University and Kinki University here in Japan are making use of AWS to serve their students. And we couldn't do this without having a broad support of our consulting partners. And here in Japan again, we have 7 premier consulting partners that help our customers get onto AWS. Cloudpak, Entity Data, Class Method, ServerWorks, TIS, NEC, and NRI are all premier partners that all have deep certifications for all of their workers to help you get onto AWS. And of course, also a very broad system of ISVs. There isn't today a software vendor that is not making sure that their software runs really well on AWS, because that's where their customers are. Many of them are also transforming their on-premise software into software that's running on the cloud, but often in a SaaS approach, such that they're not only just moving software from on-premise onto the cloud, but also giving you new modern ways of consuming that software. All of this makes that Gartner puts AWS as the leader in the cloud world. This is the magic quadrant for cloud infrastructure, and as you can see, For 6 years in a row since this quadrant has been made, AWS has had the leader position. And we continue to pioneer many services. A very important part of us deserving this leader position is our worldwide infrastructure. We now have 16 regions around the world with 42 availability zones. And we have 3 new regions announced, one in France, one in Tokyo, one in Stockholm, and one in the second one in China. And also yesterday, Nagasaki-san already announced to you a new type of region, a local region here in Japan, in Osaka, such that you can build here in the country high availability systems that can survive any type of failure. This global infrastructure is really important for many of our customers. Definitely also our younger businesses, because many of the younger businesses are not necessarily only targeting Japan, they're targeting a worldwide audience. And so they will run their systems as close to where their customers are. Just like that, many companies from outside of Japan are using the Tokyo region to target their Japanese customers. So it's really important for younger businesses to be able to use this worldwide infrastructure, because with one click of a button, they can reach their customers in Europe, or in South America, or in Australia, or in North America. And so one of those companies is Soracom. And I'd like to invite Kenta Yasukawa on stage to come talk about how they're using the worldwide infrastructure of AWS to build their young business. Kenta.
皆様こんにちは。株式会社ソラコム CTO の安川です。私もここにいる皆様の多くの方と同じように、クラウド上にシステムを構築するにあたってはワーナーの教えを念頭にですね、行っている一人です。なので本日ですね、ワーナーのセッションでこうして皆様に我々のシステム、我々が AWS の使い方をご紹介できることを大変嬉しく思っております。我々インターネットオブシングスを課題に取り組んでおりまして、たくさんの世界中のいろんなものがですね、クラウドにつながって、クラウド上のインテリジェンスを活用して、価値を生み出していく、そういった、システムを実現するための共通の課題の解決に取り組んでおります。共通の課題というのは、例えばそのクラウド上にですね、あるシステムに対してデバイスをいかにつなぐのか、それからその時のセキュリティはどう担保するのか、またデバイスの管理はどうするのか、その制限はどう乗り越えるのか、またクラウドとどうインテグレーションするのか、こういったたくさんの課題があります。これらを解決するためにですね、我々はソラコムという IoT プラットフォームを提供しております。ソラコムが提案するのは、これまではデバイスをインターネットを通じてクラウドに接続するという考え方が一般的だったと思いますけれども、我々が提案するのはデバイスを直接クラウドに接続して、必要であればインターネットに接続するという、こういう環境を提供することです。ではどうやってデバイスをクラウドに直接接続するんでしょうか。これに対するソラコムの答えがこちらです。 AWS クラウド上に 3GLTE のコアネットワークを構築して運用すること。ソラコムが実現するクラウドの直接接続というのはこういった形です。我々 AWS 上にセルラーのネットワークに必要なコンポーネントを独自に開発して運用しております。そこと通信キャリア様のネットワークと直接接続して、いわゆる MVNO、 バーチャルネットワークオペレーターの形でネットワークを提供しております。こうすることでデバイスから AWS クラウドまでの外部から侵入できない安全な通信路を提供することができます。さらに AWS 上のお客様の VPC とピアリングして、インターネットに全く出ないシステムを構築したり、またクラウド上のリソースを使ってデータの暗号化や安全な通信を提供するといった機能を提供しております。このサービスを提供し始めて以来、国内外含めてですね、6000を超えるお客様にご利用いただいております。例を挙げますと、パーソナルモビリティの新しい形を実現しようとするウィール様、それからパルコ様には、 店舗にカメラを置いてですね、客層分析をするためにクラウドを活用する、そこでデバイスを接続するためにソラコムをご活用いただいております。それから小松様には ICT 研究とクラウドとのセキュアな通信を実現するためにソラコムをご活用いただいております。また明日になるかと思いますけども、大道様もですね、弊社のシステムを活用してクラウド連携をされていますので、そのお話が聞けるとのことです。でなぜ小さなスタートアップがこれをですね、我々まだ小さなチームですけども、なぜ実現できているのかというと、その答えは AWS 上に AWS のベストプラクティスを適用して実構築しているから、こう断言できるかと思っております。こちらに示すのはソラコムの内部アーキテクチャなんですけども、左側、向かって左側ですね、がパケットの交換を行うシステムで、実際にキャリア様と直接接続する交換機等々が実現されている部分です。それから向かって右側、こちらがですね、セッション管理だったり課金だったり認証だったり、そういった各機能を実現しているコンポーネントで、それぞれがですね、マイクロサービスとして API を通して連携するような仕組みで実現しております。ご覧いただいている通り、すべて AWS 上でですね、EC2 や Amazon S3、DynamoDB などを活用して実現されています。でこのアーキテクチャはですね、ローンチ以来実は変わっておりませんで、というのも AWS 上の仕組みを使ってですね、ホライゾンタルスケーラビリティとビルトインレジリエンスを実現しているからだと思っております。ソラコムのシステムはですね、デバイスが増えるに従ってサーバーの数を増やして、キャパシティを多くしていくといったことが実現できます。またビルトインレジリエンスという考え方を適用していて、たとえサーバーが障害を起こしたとしても、それを自動的に置き換えて修復する、こういった仕組みが入っています。でこういった考え方をですね、システムの全レイヤーに投入し適用しているというのが一つの特徴です。データベースレイヤーについてもですね、Amazon DynamoDB を活用することでこういった特性を持たせています。またもう一つ、重要な要素が素結合化と非同期化というキーワードです。我々のサービスの一つでソラコムファネルというサービスを例にお話ししたいと思います。ソラコムファネルというのは、デバイスから入ってきたデータをAmazon Kinesis や Amazon S3、Amazon Redshift などのクラウドサービスに直接入力するためにですね、そのお手伝いをするサービスなんですけども、デバイスからは簡易なオーバーヘッドの小さいプロトコルでデータを送っていただいて、それを各種サービスに届けてくれます。で、その内部アーキテクチャなんですけども、この図のようにですね、Amazon Kinesis のストリームを用意して、でそこにメッセージを一旦置いて、でラムダファンクションを使ってですね、それを目的の最終的なサービスに入力すると、こういう構成をとっております。この構成をとることで入力が増えた場合にもですね、それぞれ必要な場所を必要な合わせて、スケールさせることができますし、さらに我々の開発のアジリティを上げるという点でも効果があります。例えば先日ですね、我々のパートナーさんの、サービスに対してデータを入力するアダプターを発表したんですけども、その際どういった形を取ったかというと、パートナー様にラムダファンクションを開発していただいて、我々はインテグレーションの時にはキネシスストリームを用意して、このパートナー様のファンクションと連携させる、こういった形でインテグレーションを行いました。こうすることで非常に早いペースでですね、アダプターを追加することができました。こういった素結合化と非同化、非同期化、それから AWS の各種サービスをですね、フルに活用することで、早いペースでのイノベーションを起こすということが、我々小さなチームでも実現できております。我々お客様からのフィードバックを得て、それをもとに改善を続けるというですね、AWS と同じフィロソフィーを持っておりますけれども、結果としてですね、新しいサービスを12やリリースを12回、新機能発表38回ということをこれまで実現してきております。また、AWS は我々のグローバル展開も非常にスムーズにしてくれました。昨年ですね、世界120以上の国と地域で利用可能なソラコムの SIM を発表したんですけども、その際、AWS のフランクフルトリージョンを活用してですね、システムを構築することで、非常にスムーズに新しい環境に対しても、ヨーロッパ、それからアメリカに対してもですね、サービスを展開し始めることができました。ご覧いただいた通りですね、ソラコムは AWS のという大きなグローバルインフラストラクチャーの上に構築された、IoT 時代のデバイスとクラウドを直接接続するためのサービスです。このサービスを活用してですね、星の数ほどある IoT デバイスを皆様、クラウドに接続してイノベーションを起こしていただくお手伝いができればというふうに考えております。 私の方からは以上です。ご清聴ありがとうございました。
It's an amazing story, amazing success story as well. So if you look back at the number of years, you see a clear trend shifting in IT. Where maybe in 2014, around that time, it was clear that the cloud had become the new normal.There was no discussion anymore about advantages of cloud over on-premise or co-location or things like that. It was absolutely clear already that the future of IT was in the cloud. And we saw a clear evolution happening after that. Once everybody had accepted that, it became clear also that developers became a lot more successful on the cloud as well.And if you ask them really, for what was it that sort of drove their sort of new level of productivity, is really that they felt they had complete control over their own destiny. They really could make exactly those products that they wanted to make while focusing purely on the products and no longer having to focus on infrastructure or other pieces that didn't matter to them. There's a famous paper many years ago by Nick Carr,who says, IT doesn't matter. And it wasn't that he meant that IT didn't matter, but he meant that at some level, IT is not a competitive differentiator because we all have to do the same thing. If you build your app or you build your website, you all have to implement search. It's just a requirement. Doesn't make you more competitive, doesn't make your app better, it makes it worse if you don't have it.So everybody has to implement search. That means that everybody has to run Solr and Lucene and try to make that scale. Doesn't make your product better. But instead of that, you should be using Cloud Search or Elasticsearch, so that you no longer have to worry about search, you just can add it at any time that you want. And so when I was talking to some developers,They made the joke that said that you make us feel like James Bond, yeah? And your Q. You give us all these fancy new tools that we can play with all the time that make us successful, that make us do things that we never thought were possible before. Yeah? It is as if you've given us superpowers. And so we really thought, like, wow, that's great. You know,If AWS can give you superpowers to build whatever you want to build, to escape sort of the shackles of the old style of IT, then that would be great. So let's take a look at sort of some of the different superpowers that AWS gives you. The first and foremost one I think is always important is that of supersonic speed, the ability to move fast.I think in today's business climate, real-time moving is essential. And it's not just a matter of the ability to click one button and get access to 10 or 100 or 1,000 servers. Of course, that's really important because in the past, that would take you weeks or months to get access to that kind of capacity. So yes, that makes you move fast. But equally important,is the breadth and the depth of the set of services that AWS offers you, so that you can really focus on only those things that make your product unique. And so we have now well over 90 different services in many different areas. The time that AWS was just infrastructure as a service, yeah, compute, storage, databases, network, is long gone.We give you, you want to build mobile applications? You want to build IoT applications? You want to be able to move between on-premise and in the cloud? You want to do analytics? All of these, we give you state-of-the-art services that really set us apart from any of the other cloud providers out there. It's really important. to be able to pick exactly those tools that you can use. So you'll see in many of these areas that we give you multiple offerings. We're very strong believers that we should not constrain you in the way that you want to build your systems. You're the only one that really knows how to develop those best. And as such, we give you a variety, a choice of tools to be able to achieve your goal, such that you can use exactly those tools that you need to. We will not force you into a particular development methodology. You can pick your own. Probably there's no area where it is more obvious than still in those core services. Yeah, let's take a look at those. And whether that is compute, or databases, or security, or storage, or network, in each of those, we give you a deep set of choices such that you can pick exactly those tools that you can use, want to use. Important there is also that you can make mistakes. Making mistakes is something we do all the time. Imagine that you were building your application and you were building it such that you thought, wow, this one is really going to be I/O bound. That's really going to be the constraining factor. In the old days when you had to buy hardware, you would buy hardware that really makes sure you had great I/O. But when you now run this application, suddenly you realize, oh wait, it's not I/O bound at all. It's CPU bound or it's memory bound. In the old days, you would be stuck. On AWS, just a matter of a click of a button, and you get yourself a different instance type that can really serve exactly that, what you need to do. So if you look at compute, there's many different instance families here, and also within the instance family, many different sizing choices. Important, I think, if you look at compute, is that many of them have already gone through several generations. Take, for example, the compute-intensive one, the C5s. That means that they're in their fifth generation already. If you would have had to buy hardware and be on-premise, you would be stuck with hardware for quite a while, 3 to 5 years maybe even. On AWS, we roll out new instance families and new instance types frequently, such that you always have access to the latest and the greatest processors, fastest memories, fastest networks, fastest I/O, such that you can really optimize your applications to run on all the modern architectures that are available for you. And again, we give you choice, such that you can pick exactly that what matches your needs best. And whether you just want to use the general purpose workhorses like the M4s or like the C5s, or whether you have particular needs around storage or compute, or maybe you need very large memories. Yeah. SAP HANA, for example, is very popular among many business applications today, but requires significant memory. And so the X1s are ideal for that. Or take, for example, the P2s. The G2s were graphics processors. They're The GPU boards are specifically designed to support graphics applications. But the P2s have GPU boards that are really purposeful for general purpose GPU processing, especially those that have large neural networks, such as deep learning and the new AI applications. So those boards are really important to speed up AI processing in much of the world that we see today. And hardware acceleration is something that's becoming more and more interesting for applications as well. Once you have a, let's say, stable application, you can consider to actually burn that into an FPGA array. So these are the F1 instances. So where you can really get hardware acceleration of the software products that you're running. You can build these images on your own desktop, and then load them into the F1 instances. And if you don't want to build these images yourself, there's quite a few of these hardware-accelerated images available for you in the AWS Marketplace, as well. And for example, there is one of those images that was live video encoding that runs 30 times as fast on the hardware accelerated F1s than it would run on general purpose processing. So for many of our customers, it's really important that the cloud allows them to move fast, to move with supersonic speed. And here in Japan, Entity East has been using AWS to do just that, to be able to move their business at supersonic speed. So I'd like to invite Hiroshi Nakamura on stage to talk about how they are using AWS to move at supersonic speed.
おはようございます。NTT 東日本の中村です。NTT 東日本と聞いて、おそらく電話サービスやフレッツ光といったインターネットアクセスサービスを思い浮かべる方が多いと思います。ただそれだけではありません。今日会場でご覧いただいているようなデジタルサイネージにリアルタイムに高画質な映像を配信するのも我々のサービスの一つであります。こういった大容量のデータだけでなく、企業が持つさまざまなデータをオンプレサーバーから AWS に移行する際、必ず必要となってくるものがセキュアで高帯域な回線サービスです。我々 NTT 東日本でも数多くのサービスをクラウド上で提供しておりますが、その際に使っているのがここにありますクラウドゲートウェイです。これはもともと社内で使っているものなんですけども、これを社外の方にも広く活用していただこうと、こういうふうに思って、先日発表いたしました。社内で使って便利なものを社外の方にも使っていただく、これが非常に AWS に似てるのかなというふうに思っています。では社内でどのようなサービスで活用しているか、多くのサービスの中で、2つだけ今日はご紹介させていただきます。1つは、スマートビデオ。こちらはセキュアな状態でライブ映像の配信ができるサービスです。企業の総会等でご利用いただいています。一方でこちらのスマートスタディ、事業の中継だけではなくてカリキュラムの管理、こういった機能も踏まえているため、教育業界を中心にご利用いただいています。さまざまなクラウドサービスがある中で、我々がなぜ AWS を選んだのか、その理由が大きく3つあります。コスト、スピード、アジリティ、この3つが大きく我々の要求条件としてありました。まずコストですけれども、ただ単に価格が安いだけではなく、機能と価格のバランス、これが非常に重要で、我々がサービスを出す際にも非常に重要になってきます。そして2つ目のスピード、ただ単に市場に投入するのが早いだけではなく、タイムリーな市場投入をして、市場の要求をしっかり組んでいこうといったところでございます。そして3つ目がアジリティ。さまざまな要求条件が目まぐるしく変化する中で、変化に柔軟に対応できる、こういった AWS の持つ特徴とともに、フレッツ光の高速、それから平域、この機能を直結することにより、平域での AWS 利用とセキュリティ面での安心感があったので、AWS が NTT 東日本で数多く使われるようになりました。一方で一般の企業の方のクラウドの使用状況を見てみますと、まだまだ企業の基幹システムでクラウドが利用されているとは言い難い状況であります。企業の皆様にとってクラウドの利用というのにまだまだ不安な部分がある、こういったところで、例えば インターネットで接続する際、情報セキュリティの面、あるいは通信速度の面で不満や心配がありました。一方で専用線によるダイレクト接続の際にはコストが高かったり、開通までの納期が非常に期間がかかったりします。こういったところをいかにして解決するのか、そこで我々はクラウドゲートウェイ、これを社内利用だけではなく社外の方にも使っていただこうというふうに考えました。アクセス網の光化カバー率9割以上、光アクセスサービス2000万契約、これは NTT 東西の合計でございますけれども、これを AWS と直結することにより、実は日本という国が AWS と企業の最も太く近くなっている国でなるのではないかと、こういうふうに考えています。クラウドゲートウェイの特徴ですが、安く使える、すぐに使える、使いたいときだけ使える、この3つを特徴といたしまして、ネットワークアズコード、アマゾンの考えとともに、歩んでいきたいというふうに思っています。で、このサービスを使うことにより AWS と直結して企業だけではなく、セキュアな状態が必要となる金融業界、あるいは、IoT、 こういったところにもこれから、ますます広がっていけるのではないか。リコネクト、クラウドゲートウェイを使ってアマゾンとともにですね、なお一層 AWS の利用環境を良くしていき、エンジニアたちのネットワークに対する悩みを共に解決していきたいというふうに思っています。以上です。ありがとうございます。
Thank you.
Thank you very much. If you talk about all these different instance types and the ability to move faster, maybe there's other ways to even move faster than that. And that is to use the superpower of invisibility to make some of this hard work that you still have to do when you have to run your own software in these instances go away. And that's the concept of serverless. With serverless, we've built many services within AWS already where you never have to think about how to provision them or how to scale them, or if you're not using them, that you don't have to pay for them. And many of our services are fault tolerant from the start. They will automatically spread themselves over multiple availability zones and make sure that they're always available to you. So many of these services that we've built in AWS are serverless from the beginning. You don't have to think about the instances where they're running in. That's all hidden for you. You can just use them whenever and wherever you execute your own code. So we have a whole complete set of services for you that are all managed for you, where you don't have to worry about where to run them or how to run them. But of course, there was still always one piece missing in all of this, and that was your own code. Yeah? You still had to run your own system inside a virtual machine. And we changed that for you when we launched AWS Lambda. With Lambda, you could just write your code, submit it to AWS, and we would run it for you. And we could run one function for you, or 10,000 in parallel, if that would be what you would be asking. So we would automatically scale it for you. We'll also make sure that we'll run it over multiple availability zones, so you don't have to worry about fault tolerance. And it has security built in from the ground up, so that you don't have to do any compromises at that level. So AWS Lambda has become a true powerhouse. Many companies have moved their systems over to Lambda. And not just younger, new technology businesses, actually quite a few enterprises have already started to move over to Lambda. Take, for example, FINRA. It's a government organization, a federal organization in the US that tracks all market data, all market operations in the different stock markets in the US, looking for fraud and anomalies and things like that. So literally, on a daily basis, they have thousands of events flowing into their system. In the past, they would need a whole fleet of EC2 instances to be ready just to take this processing in. Now the arrival of each of those market events just triggers a single Lambda function. And so they do billions of them on a daily basis, but they don't have to worry about provisioning or about managing or about fault tolerance or about security. All of these things are taken care of for them. Now, Lambda is great, especially if you really want to focus on building stateless applications. At least that was how it started off. But not all of our applications are built like that. Many of our applications actually make use of multiple functions. And so the coordination of that was actually pretty tricky. And using multiple functions, and do fault handling, do sequencing, how to make sure that all of these steps indeed were taken, how to keep auditing there, all of those were challenges. And so we built a system for you called step functions that helps you with this. So if you build more complex applications consisting out of multiple Amazon AWS Lambda functions, you should use step functions to do coordination. It gives you a graphical environment where you can, for example, do these sequential steps, if that's what your application wants to do, step by step, and automatic failure handling in case things go wrong there, or execute things in parallel. Yeah, if you want to do, like in this example, want to do conversion of an image to multiple formats, you can do that in parallel. Or if you have a branching application where you can do multiple branches. All of these are supported by step functions, which you can develop in a visual environment for you, making it very easy to build more complex distributed applications using AWS Lambda. If you build these distributed applications, whether you use Lambda, or whether you use a collection of EC2 instances, or whether you, for example, are making use of ECS, the EC2 container service, your applications are becoming more and more distributed. More and more components are sort of decentralized and have to work together. In a world like that, it is harder to figure out exactly where bottleneck and where challenges arrive. And for that, we've built a system for you that gives you deeper insight into such distributed applications. It's called AWS X-Ray. It allows you to do distributed tracing on your applications and get a visual overview of how the different components in your system work together and how the requests flow through that system. And you get a visual map of how your application looks like. And more important, you can see where a particular bottleneck or where particular problems arise. This is one such map. This is here are your clients, here are the different components in your system, and at the back end, you have two DynamoDB tables. And what's happening here is that these clients are seeing, that's the red part of the circle, are seeing certain issues, but you have no idea what's actually the root cause of this problem. And if you can track this back, using AWS X-Ray, you see that the root cause of that is that that DynamoDB table is not properly configured. because it is throttling client requests. And so AWS X-Ray gives you a service map and a real-time view of how your application, your distributed application, is executing. In the world of serverless, DynamoDB plays a very important role. It's a non-relational database that has very unique serverless capabilities. When we designed DynamoDB, we looked at some of the other NoSQL systems that we had built ourselves in the past and asked ourselves, what should the management interface for this be? And we looked at all these other systems that were out there and saw that they all had very complex configuration parameters. All around sort of buffer caches, connection pools, all these kind of things. And when we looked at that, we thought, why are all these configuration parameters there? And it turned out they only had one goal, to get consistent performance out of the database. I said, oh, wait, if you have to do all this complex work just to get consistent performance, maybe we should just do that for our customers. Allow them to indicate to us what kind of performance they would like to see under which particular scaling conditions, and then we will take care of the rest. So that really made DynamoDB the true serverless database, because the only thing you have to do is to tell you how much reads and writes you want to see out of the database. And we'll take care of all the scaling and the reliability and the performance management for you. Recently, we've added VPC endpoints for DynamoDB. That means that inside your VPC, your virtual private cloud, where you can cordon off a piece of the cloud for your own use, you get an endpoint there into DynamoDB, so you can directly communicate with DynamoDB from within your VPC. You don't have to go over the public internet. So it's really important for many of our customers that have particular conformance and compliance requirements. Again, DynamoDB is extremely popular among our customer base. Take, for example, Supercell, the makers of the popular Clash of Clans games and others. For them, consistent performance is extremely important, because on day one, when they launch a new game, immediately millions of players will be playing that game. So they need to be sure that the database that sits behind their games can handle any kind of load in a consistent manner, because low latency in gaming really matters. While talking about latency, we see a shift happening in the world of databases, especially because there's a whole new range of applications arriving that require microsecond response times instead of milliseconds. And we see customers then building quite complex systems. Even with using DynamoDB as a backend, they will be building caches. They will be modifying the code because these caches have different interfaces than the DynamoDB has. And they have to manage these caches over multiple availability zones. They have to handle the failure of these caches. And they have to introduce quite a bit of complexity to be able to get these microsecond response times. So we looked at that and thought, we should solve this for our customers, because we're much better suited in doing this for them than themselves. Reducing complexity helps customers build more secure and more reliable systems. So we introduced the Amazon DynamoDB Accelerator. With one click of a button, you can enable an in-memory cache in front of DynamoDB that will give you 10 times faster query performance than with DynamoDB natively. This allows you to build much faster applications. Applications, for example, in the domain of gaming, or in market trading, or in ad serving, all of those require response times in microseconds today instead of milliseconds. And again, this is a fully managed serverless environment. With one click of a button, you enable DAX, and it will be enabled in all availability zones where you have access to your DynamoDB tables. So serverless is becoming a more and more important paradigm for our customers to use. Also because it allows them to be much more cost effective and move faster at the same time. And one of the companies here in Japan that is making use of our serverless architectures is Sony Mobile Communications. And I'd like to invite Izumi Kawanishi on stage to talk about how they're using AWS for their systems.
Thank you.
はい、皆さんこんにちは。ソニーモバイルコミュニケーションズの川西でございます。よろしくお願いします。本日は、IoT に関する、私どものご紹介をさせていただきたいと思います。まあ、日頃はAWS さんには大変お世話になっておりまして、あそこの場で、御礼を申し上げたいと思います。まずですね、ソニーグループのビジネス概要ですけれども、皆さんご承知の方も多いかと思いますけれども、エレクトロニクス事業、AV 商品を中心としたエレクトロニクス事業、それから、映画や音楽などのコンテンツ事業、そして、金融事業と、まあ、この3つで構成されていまして、特にエレクトロニクス事業に関しましては、ゲームですね、プレイステーション、こちらの方はAWS さん大変お世話になっております。それから、テレビ、それから、オーディオ商品、ヘッドホン等々、そして、イメージセンサーのデバイス商品群、そして、デジタルカメラの、アルファ、まあ、そういったシリーズ、そして私どものモバイルコミュニケーションということで、スマートフォンのエクスペリアを販売したいたしております。そしてもう一つはですね、モバイルセグメントといたしましては、ソネットですね、こちらの方も、ISP の事業として展開しております。その中で、私どもですね、今月、6月にですね、エクスペリアの XZ プレミアムということで、新しい商品を投入いたします。こちらは、960fps のスーパースローモーションで動画の撮影ができるということで、新しいフィーチャーを取り入れております。でもう一方ですね、 IoT の関連商品ということで、スマートプロダクトというものを展開しております。でこちらはいくつか商品がございまして、まあ、簡単にご説明しますと、 Xperia Ear というのがあります。こちらは Xperia からですね、その日の、メールであったりとか、あるいはその日のスケジュールのようなものをですね、 Bluetooth を経由して、ヘッドセットの方にですね、アニメの声優さんの声で、まあ、教えてくれるという機能で、まあ、あたかも女性の秘書さんがいるようなそんなイメージの商品です。それから真ん中の、Xperia Touch というのは、この、ハードですね、テーブルの上に置くと、そのテーブルに映像が映し出されて、そこにタッチすることによって簡単に操作ができると、まあ、そういった商品でございます。そして、Xperia Agent の方は、まあ、これはまあプロトタイプなんですけれども、まあ、エージェントの機能を持たせた、まあ、少しロボットの要素を入れた、商品のコンセプトを今検討しております。はい、ということで、ソニーモバイルコミュニケーションの IoT の取り組みとしては、5つの、要素をですね、中心に考えておりまして、1つはデザインですね。やはり最近 IoT の商品ですと、スマートあるいはインテリジェンスといったところがキーワードになってきますので、まあ、商品のデザインについてはこだわりを持っています。そしてデバイスですね。こちらのセンサーデバイスを開発しておりますので、まあ、そういったキーの要素デバイスを、2つ目の要素として考えています。そして、ネットワークにつながりますので、ネットワーク、そしてクラウドのサービス。そして一部にはですね、やはり AI の機能を取り入れていきますので、これはいわゆるですね、万能な AI というよりは、人に紐づくようなパーソナルな AI ということで、私ども取り組んでおります。そしてそれらをまとめてシステムインテグレートしていくと、まあ、そういったような IoT のサービスを考えております。でこの出口としてはですね、スマートホーム、そしてヘルスケアで、もう一つはですね、まあ、物流、それからコネクテッドカーと、まあ、そういったところにですね、まあ、念頭において検討をしております。で今日はですね、スマートホームについて簡単にご紹介をしたいというふうに思います。で私どもはですね、スマートフォームのプラットフォームといたしまして、 まあ、販売あるいは設置の工事、それからデバイスがアプリのような、まあ、サービス、それから、それらを、まあ、カスタマーサポートするような、まあ、そのプラットフォームを構築いたしまして、でこれらをスマートフォームサービスということで、子どもの見守りであったりとか高齢者の見守り、あるいは空間の演出みたいなエンターテインメント性を持たせたもの、まあ、こういったところのサービスをご提供したいというふうに考えておりまして、テプコさんですね、東京電力さんの方と、今エンゲージしてですね、このサービスを、進めようとしていたしております。でそのユースケースを簡単にご紹介いたします。一つはですね、見守りのサービスで、まあ、これ一番簡単なんですけど、まあ、センサータグをですね、ドアとか、あるいは窓に、取り付けて、まあ、そこそのあのドアが開いたとかですね、開け閉めが分かったりとか、あるいは、お子さんが帰宅した時にそれが分かるとか、まあ、そういったような、センサーの、機能をサービスとして、構築をしております。それから2つ目についてはですね、まあ、これはあの上の方にあのマルチファンクション、LED ライトというものを、今ここに置いてありますけれども、まあ、いわゆる LED の、ライトですね。こちらにですね、Wi-Fi、それから、人感センサー、そして、スピーカー、マイクと、まあ、こういったものを持たせてですね、まあ、お子さんがもし帰ってきたりすると、まあ、それを人感センサーが感知して、まあ、ただいまというふうに言うと、まあ、外にいるお母さんが、それをですね、まあ、感知して、まあ、お帰りと言ったりとかですね、まあ、そういったあの音声でのインタラクションができるようになっています。まあ、一般にあの見守りで言うと、あのカメラで、まあ、監視するケースって多いと思いますけど、まあ、カメラで見られてるのもまあちょっとっていう方もいらっしゃるので、まあ、そういったところではこの音声によるサービスで、少し柔らかい、コミュニケーションができるというふうに考えています。そして3つ目はですね、まあ、これはあの、まあ、いわゆるあの LED の電球にスピーカーをつけたものになっていて、まあ、例えばスマートフォンから音楽をですね、Bluetooth で送って、まあ、この電球がですね、まあ、再生する、音楽を再生すると、まあ、そういったような、機能を持たせています。まあ、これはあの割と柔らかい音で、まあ、この電球もです、ね、色が変わったりとかですね、割とアンビエントな、特徴を持った商品になっています。でこういったサービスをですね、構築するシステムとして、AWS さんを活用させていただいていて、この左手の方ですね、こちらは私ども開発している商品群になります。まあ、いくつかの IoT の商品群を開発しておりまして、まあ、これらをつなぐシステムとして AWS さんを使わせていただいておりまして、まあ、ベースとしては EC2 をベースにアプリケーションのサービスを構築してますけれども、この中で赤い枠で囲っている部分ですね、中央の部分、こちらの方が AWS IoT と呼ばれる部分でして、これを使うことによって、まあ、私も非常に簡単にですね、この機器間接続あるいは機器認証といったような、IoT に必要な要素というところを、実現することができました。まあ、こういうことですね、まあ、ぜひ、皆さんもですね、 IoT 関連の、まあ、システムを作る際にはですね、ご活用いただければよろしいんじゃないかなというふうに思います。ということで、まあ、私ども、マーベルコミュニケーションはですね、今後もですね、IoT のビジネスについて取り組んでいきたいというふうに思っています。それからもう一つですね、まあ、一つ宣伝させていただくと、まあ、あちらの展示ブースの方で、私どものソニーネットワークコミュニケーションズの方から、マネージドクラウドのサービスをですね、ご紹介、展示させていただいておりますので、そちらの方もですね、ぜひですね、立ち寄っていただければというふうに思います。以上でございます。ご清聴ありがとうございました。
Thank you. Yeah, probably there's one area that clearly doesn't need servers, and that is the world of IoT. The Internet of Things is a complex world to program in. Yeah, there's many devices that live outside of the cloud, but most of the capabilities of IoT applications are actually built in the cloud. That's where the real core of many of these applications live. So we built for you a whole environment that makes it very easy to program IoT applications. In the core of all of this is something that calls is called the device gateway. That's the place where your devices that lives outside of AWS, outside of the cloud, will communicate with. We give you a device SDK that lives, that's for code that will live on the devices, so that you can securely communicate between the devices and the gateway that lives in the cloud. You can bring your own certificate, or we can issue X509 certificates for you to really uniquely identify the devices and to encrypt the communication between the devices and your applications that are within the cloud. Messages that come from the devices will flow towards what's called the rules engine. In the rules engine, a very simple SQL statement, you can do pre-processing of these messages to take default actions with. And those actions could, for example, be sort of moving them to other services, or it could be a very simple action, sort of like when temperature goes over 20 degrees, open the window, if you would have a glass house, for example. You don't really need to go back into your applications running in Lambda or in EC2 or in other environments to take those actions for you. Allows you very simple statements to build your applications. Then there's a device shadow that you can program against in case the device that you want to control is not connected at that moment. So device shadows make it look like as if the device is always there, but if the device is temporarily not connected, you don't have to change the way that you build your applications. Once the device comes back online, it picks up the instructions that are ready to wait for it in the device shadow and will execute those. So all of this together makes up AWS IoT. So let's look a bit deeper at some of those pieces. Let's start to take a look at the rules engine. The rules engine make it very easy for you to do filtering and transforming of these messages while you're passing them on to the different components that are out there. And as I said, you can even write very small statements already such that these messages never have to reach different applications, but that you can take default actions with by communicating to the device shadows. But a very important part of this is doing filtering and transformation of these messages and then moving them on to some of these other services that are out there. And all of these actions are in default encoded into the rules engine, making it really easy for you. For example, a very popular one in the IoT world is to move these messages into Elasticsearch. Specifically because Elasticsearch makes it very easy for you to build very extensive dashboarding with the Kibana toolkit that is available for Elasticsearch. So it makes it very easy to build these kind of dashboards in real time, demonstrating the information and the messaging that are flowing from your IoT devices. As I said earlier on, the device shadows is a very important concept because it allows you to program against devices even if the devices are offline. Right? Devices come in two types. They come in sensors, those that actually emit messaging, and actuators, devices that can take actions for you. And so in the device shadow, with sensors, you can get the last state of that sensor, and the device shadow will also keep the last actions that you want the actuators to take. An important combination of services in the IoT world is to make use of machine learning. Have information flow back into the machine learning components to start taking actions. And as you can see, using the rules engine, It makes it very easy to integrate Amazon Machine Learning Service with your IoT application. But if we look at sort of the really extensive, let's say, industrial IoT applications, those consist of thousands and thousands, if not tens of thousands, of small components that are continuously communicating with each other. I recently saw one of these autonomous vehicles in mining. And actually, on board is no longer one IoT system. There's actually thousands of different components on that board, on board. And they all communicate with each other. As you can imagine, there is no need for all these messages to flow back into the cloud. Yeah, there's, of course, the issue of latency, connectivity, and locality of data that is important. And if you then look at sort of what are the different components of IoT, we needed to make sure that all of them are served well, both in terms of the things, so the devices that are out there, the components that run in the cloud, and those that actually are the augmentation of all of that, your applications that hold the intelligence that's making use of the IoT capabilities. We already talked about the component that sits in the middle, the cloud one. But for many of these devices that are out there that have this very fine-grained communication among themselves, that information doesn't need to flow back into the cloud. Yet, it should stay within, for example, the domain of that one autonomous vehicle. And only summaries are being sent back into the cloud. Now, customers have asked us to give us a programming model for on those devices, local, in that local environment, or for example, that autonomous vehicle, so that they can program that in exactly the same way as that they would program their applications as they were running in the cloud. So for that, we've built AWS Greengrass, which has the same set of components as the IoT system in the cloud, but now you can run that on the device itself, where you have a gateway, where you have authentication authorization, and you have Lambda as the programming model for programming these devices. So you can make use of AWS Lambda without having to go back into the cloud. This allows you to build these very distributed, autonomous environments that do not need to be connected all the time to the cloud and can actually reduce latency within those applications. Very important for many of the applications that are built out there in that world. Now, if we go back to our superpower theme, if there is one superpower that probably speaks to everyone's imagination is that of flight. Yeah, the ability to unshackle you from the earth and to be able to fly wherever you want to go. And I think that's a great superpower to have. And it's especially relevant, I think, in the world of databases. Yeah, we really want to fly away from the way that old database vendors have been sort of keeping us on the ground and not allowing us to fly away in the way that we would want to. I think many traditional database vendors have locked us in for long periods of time. I think if there is some anti-cloud approach, it is probably most visible in the database world. The only way to drive your costs down is to make very long-term contracts. And I've been on the receiving end of that myself. You know, I never felt I was in control when I had to deal with a database vendor. And often, because I had to make these contracts for 5 or 10 years ahead, I had to estimate my usage for the coming 5 years. That was impossible. And because of all the punitive licensing that often comes with these database contracts, I would overestimate my usage. And I now know, by talking to many CIOs, I've heard that quite a few of them sort of end up with 30% unused licenses Just to be sure to not actually get some email about some audit that will go on for which you will get significantly punished if you have not bought enough licensing. So as such, many of our customers that are running these enterprise-grade databases on-premise, these commercial databases, when they migrate to the cloud, they really want to migrate to an open source database because they're basically sick and tired of dealing with this very restrictive licensing that many of the database vendors give you. And so these targets often are either as MySQL or MariaDB or this PostgreSQL. And of course, we help you with this. We've built the AWS Database Migration Service that helps you to automatically migrate your database from on-premise into the cloud in real time, in a manner such that you don't have to take down your application. And since the launch of this service, we've migrated 25,000 databases already for our customers from on-premise into the cloud. Often, this happens between two databases of the same type, but quite frequently, and more, this happens from a commercial enterprise database on-premise into an open source database into the cloud. Customers have been asking us that, yes, they really love these open source databases in the cloud because of their licensing model, but they really could use more database-grade capabilities in those databases. Basically around consistent performance, about reliability, about fault tolerance. So for that, we built Amazon Aurora, an enterprise-grade database backend with very unique reliability capabilities that has a MySQL frontend. So all the standard tools that you use with MySQL are capable of using Amazon Aurora, but you get performance and reliability of that of a high-end enterprise-grade database. Amazon Aurora is the fastest growing service on AWS that we've ever built. Very popular with our customers. Customers then immediately started asking whether they could get a PostgreSQL version as well. Because the migration from some of these enterprise-grade commercial databases to PostgreSQL is often much easier than to MySQL. That's why at reInvent last year, we launched Amazon Aurora PostgreSQL edition, and I'm happy that it is now available in open preview for everybody to use. So if you're interested in this, please sign up and start making use of it. As I said, Amazon Aurora is really popular with our customers, fastest growing service ever. And some customers are building significant systems on top of this. For example, Expedia, which runs 150 different travel sites around the world, is making use of Aurora as a centralized database hub. Typical updates in Expedia are 300 million writes a day, sometimes with peaks of 17,000 writes a second and 35,000 reads a second, all with consistent performance. And since Aurora is really demonstrating to really have brought enterprise-grade databases to this world at the cost of an open source one. So migration is important for many of our customers, and we give all sorts of support for that. And some of our customers actually migrate thousands of applications over to AWS. One of those customers is Green. I'd like to invite Masaki Fujimoto on stage to talk about how they've been migrating their systems onto AWS. Masaki.
こんにちは。 クリー株式会社の藤本と申します。で、まず最初に僕らについてちょっとだけお話をさせていただきますと、僕らの会社はですね、2004年に、最初はソーシャルネットワーキングサービスの会社として始まって、そこから、ブラウザーのソーシャルゲームで、ネイティブのソーシャルゲームですとか普通のネイティブゲームで、今は VR ですとかあとメディアとかをやっていたりする会社なんですけど、実はこれが本当に言いたいことではなくって、ちょっと自虐的すぎてこのスライドはちょっとスライドにはしなかったんですけど、ここでお伝えしたいのが、僕らはですね、すごく声を大にしてお伝えしたいわけじゃないですけど、大体2013年くらいからの4年間、ある種順当に業績がずっと下降し続けてまして、株価もなんですけど、でこれは本当に結構大変でした。で、なんだろうね、まだいたのとか言われて、全然生きてると思いながら、やってきたんですけど、で本当、大変だし、その間いろんなことを、試したりとか試行錯誤したり、ストラグルしたりっていう4年間で、おかげさまで、過去2回の四半期は、業績を回復するような絵を皆さんに見せることができて本当良かったなと思うし、チームのみんな本当ありがとうと思っているんですけど、でその中で、本当いろんなことを試したり、でその中でうまくいったこともいかなかったこともありますということでですね、でその中でですね、うまくいった、やってよかったなっていうことの一つで、あれですね、AWS にこうで、僕ら大量のサーバーをオンプレミスで持ってたんですけど、そのうちの何千台かっていうことを AWS に移行するということをして、これはやってよかったなということで、ここでその例をお話をさせていただこうと思っています。おかげさまでこうして、何でしょうね、AWS のキーノートでお話をする機会もいただけて本当にありがとうございます。はい。で、数千台のサーバーで、サービスにしたら20とか、そのぐらいのことを、やりましたということでございます。で、どれぐらいの期間でやったかっていうと、1年ぐらいでこれぐらいの数を移行しております。で、これは実はちょっと持っていて、実際プランニングとか入れると、倍以上の時間がかかってたりするんですけども、そういったこと、オペレーションとしては1年間ぐらいこういうことをしておりました。いや、本当大変だだったねと思っておりますが、みんなの努力のおかげで、こういったことも、全然できますということをまず1個目お伝えしたいと思います。で、どうやるのみたいな話があると思うんですけど、で使ったサービス、こうやっていろいろあったりします。で、でもっと全然使ってるんですけど、何より問題はこうあれですね、こうスライド作って1ヶ月ぐらい経ってみると、このロゴとサービス名が全然一致しないで、EC2 とかは、から、始まって、そういった当たり前のサービスがあるし、先ほどのデータベースで言えば、RDS とか、その他ものも使っています。で、その中で、もちろんどれが欠けても厳しかったんですけども、一番何でしょうね、これがなかったら絶対できなかったっていうのはすごく地味ですけど、やっぱりダイレクトコネクトですねと思っています。で、そもそもそういうことができるのできないのみたいな話が、移行の時に始まると思うんですけども、そういうことではないんですと思っていまして、やるかやらないかで、やるっつったらやるんですと。で、全くどうでもいい話を一瞬しますけど、僕の好きな作品の名言にですね、まず決める、そしてやり通すっていう言葉がありまして、これで何の作品が分かった方はきっと僕と美味しいお酒が飲めるので、あとご連絡をくださいと思っているんですけど、ですで、ただこれただの精神論で、これは大事なことのうちの 1% です。あとの 99% は、ちゃんとしたテクノロジーのベースがあるかどうかということです。で、どうやったかというと、今までもこういった普通のことをやってます。で、L3 でつないでレプリカを作って移行する、これは普通です。なんで、ちゃんとしたテクノロジーとちゃんとした準備があればできることだなと思っています。でもそんな中で、本当にトラブルなく1年を通じてほとんどトラブルなく移行ができたのは、本当に僕らのチームは優秀だなと思っているし、パートナー様にご協力いただいたりというところもすごくあるし、何より、いわゆるインフラチームとプロダクトのチームあることが多いと思うんですけど、どちらかが非協力的でも進まないので、こうやって、全体一丸となるような、進め方っていうのもすごく大事だなと思っていますが、何しても何が言いたいかというと、ここはですね、うちのチームが優秀だからこそできたことだなということで、もしそういうことをお考えになっている方がいらっしゃいましたらですね、ぜひご相談をいただけると一緒にお仕事ができて嬉しいなと思っています。ちなみにこれは宣伝なので、 よろしくお願いしますということで、興味ある方はぜひこの後ご連絡をくださいと、この場を借りて宣伝をさせていただきます。で、で、まあ、なんでやるかで、これいろんなことを、皆さんなぜいいかっていうことは言ってまして、その中であんま語られないけど一つだけ挙げると、増やす、すごく増えていいよねっていう事例いっぱいあるんですけど、経験ある方もいらっしゃいますけど、サービスは伸ばすよりも減らす方が、サーバー減らす方が難しいですっていう時に、すごくいいなっていうのも一つ利点として挙げておきます。で、まあまあ、こういったとこ、こういった要素もありますし、で、僕らはですね、技術選択をする、実装 A と B どっちがいい、フレームワークどれがいい、ミドルウェアどれがいい、アーキテクチャどういうのがいい、どのサービスを使おうかっていうことを僕らは常に、し続ける必要があります。で、その、軸として本当にいろんな、プロセスだとかいろんな要素があるのは皆さんご存知の通りです。で、これらを全部評価してパラメータを出したとしても評価するっていうのはすごく難しいです。なぜかというと、その正解不正解は、未来がどう進むかによって圧倒的に変わってしまうので、これを正しい選択をするっていうことは未来を正しく予測するっていうことに他ならないので、これは本質的にすごく難しいですので、多くの場合、まあ、そういうループに陥ってどっちがいいかよくわからないみたいなことになるという時に、本当に最後の最後、僕は何より大事だし、迷ったら、ここを考えようというところで1個だけ挙げると、それは早いかどうかっていうことで、もうコンピューターが早くて困ることって絶対ないんです。なんで、増やすのが早いか減らすのが早いか開発が早いかなどなど、本当に、いろんな要素があると思うんですけども、そういったものが早いかどうかっていうのを、まあ、最後考えて、まあ、これが早いならやればいいし、早くないならやめればいい、まあ、そういったところで最後の最後シンプルに考えるのはすごく大事だなと思っているし、まあ、何でしょうね、AWS を使えばですね、まあまあ、こういった期待には応えてくれるんじゃないかと、最後に宣伝しておけばワーナーがきっと褒めてくれるんじゃないかと思って、僕のお話を終わりたいなと思います。ということで、では最後に、最後のワーナーの、セクションになりますけど、皆さんもお楽しみください。以上です。ありがとうございました。
So when you have all this data, you still need to do something with it. And one of the most important things I think today which you can do with your data is to analyze it. I think cloud has given everyone, whether you're a small business or an enterprise or a medium business, access to exact the same compute capabilities, the same storage, the same analytics services. So it really becomes important, what data do you have and what kind of questions can you ask to your data? Data will become a major competitive differentiator between businesses, and the kind of analytics that you do on them to support your business operations will be extremely important. So we made it able for you to actually run petabyte scale analytics already on AWS. We give you three different services for that. Amazon Athena, that allows you to do ad hoc querying, EMR, that allows you to build complex, state-of-the-art, very targeted analytic applications, and Redshift with data warehousing. So Amazon Athena allows you to store your data in S3 and run ad hoc queries directly on that data that you stored in S3. And you only have to pay for those queries that you run. It's great for interactive and ad hoc querying. But if you have more complex, very unique analytics requirements, you may want to build those analytics capabilities using some of those open source tools available for you, like Hadoop and Spark and Presto and HBase. All of those are supported by Amazon EMR, Amazon Elastic MapReduce. It allows you to run it on a cluster of 10 nodes or a cluster of 1,000 nodes and operate on any data set that you have available to you. The third analytics capability comes out of Redshift, which is our data warehouse service. Now, data warehousing is different from the other two analytics capabilities. Data warehousing in general pulses data from many different data sources. And those data sources have a requirement of referential integrity, meaning that if you build a financial report and you get things out of your product database and you get things out of your financial database, that the product numbers, for example, in both need to be identical and guaranteed to be identical. So those kind of capabilities are important if you build a data warehouse. So very complex structures that need to execute really fast. But again, this is a data warehouse that you don't need to run 24/7. You can run it for a few hours with 10 nodes or 100 nodes whenever you want. Data warehousing is no longer a centralized capability within your organization. Each business unit basically can run a data warehouse by themselves just for that time period that they really need it. It's extremely fast. And as such, we have many customers that really, truly love Redshift. And many of them are giving, continue to give us feedback about how they would like to see Redshift extended with new functionality, which is probably why Redshift is the service within AWS that has most frequent feature updates. These are executing really fast, iterating really fast to bring the new features that you're asking about in their hands. One particular question that came back from our customers was whether we could actually start making use of the data lake capabilities of S3 to run the Redshift queries on. A data lake means that you store all original source data of updates that you've made to your databases in one location. The traditional operation in the data warehouse, however, is to move that data towards the data warehouse and then do local operations on that. We have very large data sets in S3 that becomes very costly and time consuming. So customers asked us for a solution there. And so we built Redshift Spectrum that allows you to run complex data warehouse queries directly on data that lives in S3 without having to move that data into Redshift itself. You register the data that you have in S3 with the AWS data catalog, and then in Redshift, you can point to that as an external table and then execute the queries on that. So we've done a significant test of that against an exabyte data set. And this is a typical data warehouse query. Four tables, in this case, one of them lives in S3 and three others are local, probably a fact table and a dimension table. And then, you know, you add some filters, you do some joins, you do some group buys, some orders. Yeah, all of these kind of things that you do when you build really complex data warehouse services, the queries. And so we built this first on this exabyte data set that lives in S3, making use of Hive. And Hive, in this particular case, runs on a 1,000-node cluster. To run this query, this complex data warehouse query, using Hive, will take you 5 years on a 1,000-node cluster. Can you imagine what the AWS bill will be at the end of those 5 years? It's not very cost-effective. Using Redshift Spectrum, however, this completes in 155 seconds. A very complex data warehouse query on an exabyte of data only takes 155 seconds at a significant reduced cost, I think of a few hundred dollars. Against an exabyte of data, that's amazing. Immediately, customers have flocked to this. And also here, NTT Docomo, for example, is already making use of Redshift Spectrum to do analytics on data that lives in S3. A particular type of analytics is making use of to look towards the future, to make data, use data from the past to make predictions about the future. Machine learning is a capability that we've been exploiting at Amazon.com, the retailer, for 20 years already. Many of the features that you see on Amazon website are driven by machine learning, almost from day one. Take, for example, recommendations or similarities. Or, for example, the browse notes that you see on the left side when you issue a query. We use it at other places as well. For example, inventory level predictions or fraudulent order predictions. We have billions of orders at Amazon, and we would not be smart if we not be using that information from the past to sort of score new orders that are coming in, whether we think that they are fraudulent or not. So we have a lot of experience in using machine learning. And also many of our customers are making use of AWS to use machine learning. For example, Netflix has built a recommendation engine that's become really famous. About 75% of the movies watched on Netflix are triggered by a recommendation. As such, you can imagine that machine learning is really important to them. It allows you to make data from the past to build smarter applications. And so, core in that, at the lowest level, is both machine learning and deep learning. And so machine learning service on AWS allows you to build these simple machine learning capabilities. We have an AMI that allows you to execute most of the well-known frameworks for deep learning, TensorFlow, Caffe, MXNet. And we've even made investments into MXNet, which has now been accepted by Apache into their incubator program. We really selected MXNet because it really matches the way that we would like to serve our AWS customers. Many of the frameworks, other frameworks, only allow you a declarative approach. But you want to build empirical programs as well, and MXNet allows you that. It also gives you a choice of different programming languages, Python, C++, Java, others. So our customers, if they use MXNet, are not restricted in building their deep learning layers in only one particular way. So either you make use of ML, with data that comes out of S3 or Redshift, and the result of that is a software component, an endpoint that you can use to ask queries against. For example, this is something you would use if you would be building a fraudulent order prediction service. In the case of deep learning, the result is a model that either you execute on the edge or in the cloud using Lambda. In both cases, the success of the Amazon machine learning service was that you no longer needed to be an expert to use machine learning. In the case of using the deep learning AMIs, you still need to be an expert. And I think there will be significant effort happening at that particular level. But many of you will never become a deep learning expert because you're building applications, you're building programs that serve your customers. And as such, we've been building applications on top of deep learning that make it easy for you to use these deep learning capabilities but apply to a particular target area. The three different services that we're launching on top of our deep learning platform. First, there is Amazon Recognition, which is an image recognition service, where, for example, you can upload an image, and we will tell you with what likelihood particular attributes are in that image. And whether that is an image like this of an urban area, or whether it's, for example, faces. Are they wearing glasses? Are they smiling? And you can use this with the general training data that we've used with recognition, or you can bring your own training data and make use of the facial search functionality of recognition. For example, C-SPAN in the US is a non-profit TV channel that broadcasts all political proceedings. And one of the tasks that they have is to recognize which politician is speaking at which moment and then attribute whatever is being spoken at that moment to that politician. When one of the architects of C-SPAN saw the announcement of recognition, he knew immediately what he could do with this. Because at this moment, they were still doing that by hand, recognizing politicians and then recognizing and then recording whatever they were saying. So in 3 weeks, he built a system that allowed him to fully automate this process of recognizing which politicians to use, because they had 100,000 images of these politicians and could use their own training data. And then built the system so they could save a lot of manual labor there. We added some more capabilities into recognition recently, and one of them is important if you run an environment where you have user-generated content. One of the things that customers have asked us for is whether we could help them with doing content moderation to make sure that no inappropriate imaging arrives on your website. If you ask for this image, it will tell you that this is a suggestive image, a male swimwear or underwear. Believe me, there are 9 more severe categories than this one that you can be notified about if you want to do content moderation. The second service that we've built on top of deep learning for you is that ability for text to speech. It's called Amazon Polly. And basically, you can use text and it will interpret this smartly to be able to speak exactly what you want. So in this particular case, you don't want it to say the temperature in WA is 75°F. You really want it to say the temperature in Washington is 75 degrees Fahrenheit. It has 47 different voices, 24 different languages, and really is able to, in a lifelike manner, produce spoken text. It's important also that the output of this is something that is license free. So you can take the MP3s that come out of this and continue to use that without having to worry about licensing of that. And we've been able to add all sorts of annotations to it, such that you can add emotion to the speak. You can go loud or have pauses. And recently, we even offered the ability to whisper. We also gave you abilities to add speech marks to this. If you have avatars, for example, that you really need to synchronize with how it is being spoken, we have this ability to have speech marks such that you get synchronization between how the avatar moves and this text that is being spoken. The third service that we've built for you is Amazon Lex, the ability to do automatic speech recognition and natural language understanding. Those two are combined with each other. Basically, you give it an audio file, it will recognize the speech in there, and then do natural language understanding on that speech, and then execute a lambda function that you want to have with each of the different utterances that may appear in that speech. For example, it might be a weather forecast application. And of course, it often goes in combination with Polly to be able to not only take speech in, but also to talk back to your customers. So Amazon Lex gives you this both speech recognition and natural language understanding in a fully managed service. It also integrates with many different of the enterprise connectors. And we have already quite a few customers that are integrating Lex into their systems. For example, if you're using Slack, you have the ability to build chatbots in Slack using natural language understanding and automatic speech recognition using Lex, because Slack has integrated Lex into their programming environment. So with all of this, I want to close off with probably the one thing, the one superpower that we all want, that of immortality. And I think mostly, I think, of course, we would like that for ourselves, but we definitely would like that for our businesses. And if we look at sort of the current business landscape, many of the household names today are that of young businesses. Take, for example, Airbnb. Each night, 450,000 people are spending a night in a room brokered by Airbnb. Any hotel chain would kill for these numbers. All these enterprises are under pressure by all these young businesses that have grown up on the cloud. And they're able to move fast and to scale fast because they're no longer constrained by any of the traditional IT capabilities. IT no longer is a competitive differentiator. The playing field has been leveled. Everyone has access to the same capabilities, whether you're a young business or an enterprise. Of course, many of the enterprises are realizing this and going for a digital transformation phase to be able to move as fast and to be as innovative as that the younger businesses are. And we see significant changes happening. And probably the best example in all of this is General Electric, GE. Jeff Immelt, the CEO of General Electric, recently made a statement, says, one night you go to bed as a manufacturing company, and the next day you wake up as a software and analytics company. Really signaling the changes that GE is going through. And GE is probably one of the best examples of a company that is continuously able to reinvent themselves. GE is the only company left of the original S&P 500. 50 years ago, the average lifetime of a company on the S&P 500 was 60 years. Today, it's 15 years. The expectation is that by 2025, 75% of the companies that are now in the S&P 500 will no longer exist. And that many of the powerhouses will be those young startups that have grown up on the cloud. But we help enterprises as much as these young startups to really transform themselves, to be able to continue to compete, and to maybe also achieve immortality. We definitely do this by giving you a very deep and broad set of services that each of you can use to build exactly those applications that you want to build in the way that you want to build them. You have full control over this. Broad and deep set of services is key to success in the cloud. Last year, we launched well over 1,000 new major features and services for you. And we're well on the way this year to beat that again this year. Especially because we work so closely together with you, our customers, to add exactly those features and that functionality that you're asking for such that you can be successful in our cloud. So with all these different new features and services, I think there's no better time to build systems and applications. So with that, I would say go build, and thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.
以上でキーノートを終了いたします。